This morning, I want to share with you a couple of things. Towards the end, a challenge that we have as a body. So we're going to be doing that. Let's start here this morning. This past week has been quite a ride weather-wise, hasn't it? Spring came on 20th, which was Monday. Then we had weather like it was winter, like on Wednesday. Going to work, it was 25 degrees out. Coming home on Friday, it was 71 degrees out. It's been quite a ride here, and it was nice yesterday and rainy today. And you know, when I was a kid, I used to think, that's amazing. How can they tell what the weather's going to be tomorrow? How can he do that? I wish I knew what was coming tomorrow. That'd be so cool. And in my mind was this whole thing that there was somebody just able to predict what was going to happen tomorrow. And I thought, why, if they can do that with the weather, why can't they do that with other things? And then, when you kind of get older, you learn some things. How they can tell that weather-wise, they use weather maps. Of course, those weather maps are based in meteorology. And there's a whole study of high-pressure areas like these in fronts and low-pressure areas like these. And sometimes those can get pretty complex with all those fronts and things. And this is probably the best map of all. Here it shows the movements then with the fronts of the air flows and how the air flows flowing from higher concentrations to lower concentrations and temperature changes cause you to see how the weather is moving. These are called weather patterns and what's coming down. Of course, sometimes they get surprised because a low pressure area will get pushed down and actually cause the wind to go in a different direction. But nevertheless, I can create the same things, and I do sometimes in my shower. I do. I create wind flows. You know, you've heard of ocean breezes, right? Where does that come from? Well, it comes from the temperature of the water and the temperature of the land changing its temperature, and then the flow from higher concentrations to lower concentrations, and it's how the weather moves around. And I'm able to create some actual winds in my bathroom by those higher concentrations and lower concentrations. Oh, no, 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 no. I am not going there. You went there. I didn't go there. You know, God has a pattern. You know that? It's a pattern that presents predictability. Jesus even drew attention to this predictability by patterns, liking it to weather. He said this. He answered and he said to them, "When it is evening, you say it will be fair weather because the sky is red." That's why we know it's predictable. And you know, there is a predictability about that. If we would talk about the sunshine through certain atmospheric conditions causing a red glow. And he goes on and he said this, "And in the morning, it will be foul weather today because the sky is red and it's threatening." Weather conditions, predictability by patterns. He adds, "Hypocrites, you know how to discern the face of the sky, but you cannot discern the signs of the time." What's he referring to? He's referring to what God said was coming down, and there is, for that reason, predictability about where we are at concerning his timetable and what he's doing. That was Jesus. Unpredictability by patterns drawn from the weather for us to see. You know, there is for us this morning a characteristic of God that gives us predictability. For example, these characteristics of God present a pattern for us to see. Therefore, we have an awareness of what will happen. Here's an example. We call these God's MOs, God's modus operandi, how God operates because of where he's at with this. As a matter of fact, this is part of knowing God, is you know how he operates. You know what he does based on what he says. He is like. This is how he is. This is what he will do. Here, for example, God opposes the proud. He resists proud people, but he gives grace to the humble. And he says that over and over and over. It's his MO. It's how he operates. It's a pattern. Therefore, it's predictable. Let's see. Pride comes before a fall. Well, how do you know that? And you know, we all will experience it based on Proverbs, because it tells us that this is where God is at. This is predictable. You can take a look at it, Proverbs 6:18, if you'd like. Here's another one, a pattern that God has. If anyone lacks wisdom, let him do what? Ask God. Notice there's application when we have God's predictability. There's application because he says, based on this one, humble yourself, therefore, under the mighty hand of God, so that he will exalt you. There's application from his predictability. If we lack wisdom, ask God, and what will God do? What's his MO? What will he do? He'll give it. That's what he says. Ask God, and this God gives generously to all without holding it against you. There's no rebuke in this. Lord, I don't understand where to go with this. Ask, and it will be given. What? This wisdom. It will be given. God's pattern, therefore, its predictability, and it has application for us as to what we ought to do to interact with him. And you know, there are many of these. As a matter of fact, this is part of knowing God. You know his pattern. And therefore, there is predictability in what I ought to do because of that. Very important. Very important. Well, this morning, we're going to talk about a pattern that is characteristic of God and is to be characteristic of us. We know what to do, how to act on this because of God's pattern and therefore predictability in what we should do in light of what he will do. I want you to turn with me, if you would, to the book of Revelation, chapter 19. This is so much God's pattern that it is absolutely immersed throughout all of the scriptures, from Genesis through the book of Revelation. It is so much his pattern, characteristic of him, that this is how he is called. This is what he is named by. You know how you call somebody, hey, Red, how you doing? Now, why would you call somebody Red? Red hair. Hey, Slim, how are you? What gives rise to that? How about this? Grumpy? Happy? Yeah. This is so characteristic of God and his pattern that he's actually called by this. If you're with me, Revelation chapter 19, verse 11, where John takes us to the future. This is the revelation of Jesus Christ. So we'll know what's soon going to take place. Verse 19. Then I, John, saw heaven opened, and behold, a white horse. The one sitting on it is called Faithful and True. And in righteousness he judges and makes war. This morning, we're going to talk about this pattern of God that is so much him that he's called this faithful and true. Faithful and true. Faithful as always. God to you and you to who? That's what we're going to talk about this morning. Because this is one of those fruits that God's Spirit in us produces. The fruit of the Spirit is, are they running through your mind right now? Peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness. That's what his Spirit produces. It's what he's called, faithful and true. It's to be our pattern so we are predictable and people will know what to do. It's where we're going to go this morning. God to you, and you to who? And that's for you to answer.
I don't want to be predictable.
We all have personalities. Personality is a good thing. Matter of fact, God is personality. Totally personality. Totally personality. And there is an element of this that makes predictability. Well, you tell me what you think of it. This is how we're going to talk about this morning. We're going to talk about when it comes to calling on the Lord, when it comes to that, when it comes to this, predictability because of character. How desirable is that? And what you can count on him to do. That's what we're going to be looking at this morning in the book of Revelation here. You know, Jesus said, "By this is my Father glorified, that you bear much fruit." This is part of that fruit. Your character reflecting his pattern. Faithful. Let's talk about this then. When it comes to calling on the Lord. There's a revelation for you in this. This is an unveiling. Something for you to have and to hold here. Yeah, is there anything faithful about that? To have and to hold from this day forward, for better, for worse, for sickness and in health, for richer, for poorer. And thereto, I pledge you my faithfulness. Here, this is for you to have and to hold from this day forward. And I saw heaven open, and behold, a white horse, and the one sitting on it is called Faithful. He's called Faithful. You know, there is a theologian, I know a few of them. There's one by the name of Wayne Grudem. He's pretty, what shall I say, well known in regards to his teaching. He actually wrote, can you imagine how long it would take to write that? There's only a few pages. Right, I agree with you. 1,256 pages. And he talks about this thing of God's faithfulness. This aspect of God's truthfulness, his faithfulness. Faithfulness means that God will always do what he said and fulfill what he has promised. He'll always do it. He'll always bring forth his promise. And he gives a bunch of verses here. He, God, can be relied upon, and he will never prove unfaithful to those who trust what he has said. Indeed, the essence of true faith is taking God at his word and relying on him to do as he has promised. That is a preeminent theologian. You want to borrow this sometime from me? You're welcome to. As a matter of fact, if you do, I'm going to write your name down because I don't want to lose it. Faithfulness. You can count on him to do what he said he would do. That's his faithfulness. Why is he called faithful? This isn't a trick. And it's not really deeply profound. Why did John, pardon me? Because he does it. To the very end of human history, when he returns from heaven, he will be called and known as faithful. That's why. It's just this in-between time. It's now until he comes that we have the struggle with faithfulness. Oh, not in knowing this, but in using this. It's not a new thing, by the way, that human beings struggle with using this. Though it's altogether predictable, because it is completely his pattern, so much so that he is called this when he shows up again. Faithful has come. Old Faithful is doing it again. Huh. Imagine that. Wow. You know, like I said, this isn't new. The book of Joshua, and not the Joshuas that we have in here, okay, not our present day Joshua. This is Joshua from the Old Testament. You know, his book of Joshua, it had some really interesting things in it that took place. Can you recall any of those things? Jericho. Joshua fit the battle of Jericho and the walls. Did they? They did. They fell down flat. Absolutely flat. And, whoa, you should have seen the earth movers that they had to come in to tear those puppies down. I mean, they had to pull some real blast and blow in there to get those walls down. Right? They blew a horn all together. Let's do it now. And the walls fall down flat. And you know, the amazing thing is God told them. He told them. And well, what do I do here? This is a big fort. And we are, you know, we are puny people. We're scared to go in here into this land. We're puny people. Do this. And they'll fall down flat. Oh, sure. They'll fall down flat. That's what will happen. They fell down flat. There was only one thing that went on for Joshua. There was a couple other things. Right after that, they had the battle of Ai. God is on this. We can so go for this. And what happened? They got defeated at the battle of Ai. Why? Because God told them, and they, oh no. Now, we can get away with this. And there was one guy. What was his name? Achan. And Achan thinks, you know, I really got a better plan than God. I mean, look at this. I can really go somewhere with this. I can really have wealth if I just hang on to this. I mean, disregard what he said about giving up all of this. Just let me hang on to this. And what happened? They got defeated, and Achan died. He hung on to zero, zilch. His family and his house all went down the tube. Why? Because God said, don't hang on to this for yourself, and I've got a better idea. I'm going to hang on to this for myself. I'm not going to. And they ended up having sin in the camp. And what God said would happen if you did that, happened. You see, this goes two ways. You go along with him and you say, whoa, look at this. This is blessing. And you know what he says. But, you know, I really need to hang on to this cash for me. When you know what he says, and guess what? It's like putting money in a pocket with, where'd that go? I used to have. How does this happen? Because God has a pattern, and it is characteristic of him, and you cannot escape the pattern. It is predictable for you or against you. God is opposed to the proud, but he gives grace to the humble. Humble yourself, therefore. Humble yourself. Lest somebody else come and pick up your dough. It's predictable. He's 100% faithful. He will do what he says. You know, we could go on and on. I'd love to talk about all these things. Because once they got it together, they went back to Ai. And what happened that time? They defeated Ai hands down. And the fear of them and of the Lord went throughout all this land that they were taking. Remember how God backed up the rivers of Jericho all the way back, and they walked through and they took possession of the land? And it's so cool to see what have they do. If you take it this way, you'll get it. If you don't take it that way, this is what's going to happen. You clean out the land and this is what you'll get. If you don't clean out the land, that's what you'll get. And boy, did Israel get bothered by that for years and years and years and years. The Gibeonites, remember them? And that was in there. That was so much fun. The sun standing still. Whoa, I wonder how that's upset the symmetry of things. You know, this has to keep moving along because there is an order to this movement of weather. And when the sun stands still, that's a major magnetic force, and it's going to stand still. What's going to happen to the order of things? Ah, the sun stood still. That's crazy. God had it stand still. Everything came together because God is predictable. He acts based on what he said and the way he is. As a matter of fact, this is so much a part of it that after all that stuff that goes on in Joshua's life, he comes to the end, and I want you to hear what he says. Listen to this. This is Joshua chapter 23, verse 14. He says this, "And now I am about to go the way of all the earth." What way is that? You die. Let's see. "The day of you eat of it, you shall surely die. And now that is the way of all the earth." Isn't that amazing? It's predictable. "And you know," Joshua goes on to say, "in your hearts and souls, all of you, you know that not one word has failed of all the good things that the Lord your God promised concerning you." Not one word has failed. Not one word has failed. You all know it. You've seen it. "The Lord your God promised concerning you, all of it has come to pass for you, and not one of them has failed." Joshua says that at the end of his life's journey, and they all knew it. They all knew it. God is faithful. He is faithful in that. And you know, those folks, without them, we are not brought to the completion of what God's plan is here for us. Hebrews chapter 11. They, without us, are not made complete. God has provided something better for us, that they, with us, were helped by them. That's better, because they had to live with it, and now we learn from it for what we have to live with. Hebrews chapter 11, verse 40. God is faithful. He's promised it. He will surely do it. He's going to. 1 Thessalonians 5:24. That's to you. That's to me as the church. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 24. "He who has called you is faithful. He said it. He's going to do it." That's what faithfulness is, that God can be relied on to do what he said. And did I tell you that this is absolutely enormous in God's message to us, the revelation of it? From beginning to end, he is making that point to us. It's absolutely enormous, absolutely enormous. There are so many situations where it happens that they stumble on doing what God says, and he delivers. And it's like, ah! As a matter of fact, one time they're praying for Peter's release. You remember that? And suddenly Peter's knocking at the door. He's in prison. He's not knocking at the door. What's the matter with you? Stumble on God's faithfulness. "And he is called true." Now, this is very important. These two actually to go together. These are together. Say that with me. These are together. That he is faithful and true. Say that with me. These are together. This is together because these come together. What this true means is that he is real. He is what is real. He is what is real. That's what true means, that this is real. And in a sense, he talks about him as being the true God. In other words, he's the real God. You know, some people have different, well, many people. As a matter of fact, most people
have a different God than the God who is real. For a matter of fact, some even have their God is their belly. How about that? Can I tell you that even though that sounds gross, you know, you see a big belly and you worship it. Oh my Lord and my God. But can I tell you that there's a lot of people who live there because it talks about what they want is their God, what they have an appetite for, what they desire. It's just what I feel. And in our postmodern, post-true era, the truth is within you. You'll just feel it. You know what that makes it? The God that you have is your belly. That's what that is. It's just what I feel is right. It's just what I want. It just doesn't feel right. Hey, I want you to know feelings are important, but feelings can get out of place really fast. As a matter of fact, Time magazine recently had an article that was called "Is Truth Dead?" 51 years ago, they had an article called "Is God Dead?" 51 years now, is truth dead? And you know why? Because we live in a post-truth era. It doesn't matter if it's true or not. Say it and get people riled up and go with you, and you get what you want, and that makes God your... Isn't that amazing? So, here we are in a sophisticated 21st century, and we've gone all the way back to God being your belly. Now, I want you to know that's not the real God. A lot of people feel that that is, and it is. It's not the real God. It's not the real one. It isn't. Because even when folks get what they want, they're not necessarily satisfied. And you and I have experienced that. How many times you're really looking forward to get this and you get it and it's kind of like, big deal. Still not satisfied. What's next? What's next? God is your what? Really? No, not really. He's not really God. It's not really God. It's not. He is true. He's the real God. And from his mouth comes truth, which means he tells us that which conforms to what's real. He tells us this is what's real. This is so big. In Psalm 42, you know, there are just so many places to talk about this. As a matter of fact, that's what the whole thing of ministry is about. It's all the places where we can talk about this thing. That God, what he says, conforms to what's real. If we took, for example, this one, which is so big today, depression. God talks to us about what's real concerning being depressed. You ever have feelings that you're up? Life is good. And then feelings that you're down. It's hard to drag through this. I do. You do. We all have feelings. We all do. Sometimes they're up. Sometimes they're down.
You know, the Bible talks to us about depression. For example, listen to this, Proverbs chapter 12, verse 5. Anxiety in the heart causes depression. Did you hear that? Anxiety in the heart causes depression. It weighs it down. And boy, we could talk about anxiety and what that is and how this causes the heart to be weighed down. Depression. Now, what God says is what conforms to what is real. Because He's the real God, what He says conforms to what's real. And He tells us about how to deal with this. And boy, could we spend a lot of time talking about that? As a matter of fact, I have. And I do. And I've had to conform to what's real in my own life concerning this. And as you do, you find God's faithful. And He's true. In this psalm talks repeatedly about depression. It says it like this: Why are you cast down, O my soul? Why are you thrown to the ground? And why are you disquieted within me? Why isn't this thing settled and peaceful? Then it goes on. And he talks about hope in God and what we do with that hope in God. Psalm 42, it talks about, and this conforms to what is real. And when I begin to take that, and contrary to what I am saying to myself inside by my own wants and desires, begin to agree with God and direct myself, instruct my soul to go this way, suddenly I begin to see that there's an up to this down. And I begin to go up this downward feeling spiral, because feelings are followers of what you're saying, thinking, and doing. They're followers of that. I can begin to go back up, have them following the truth. And I can deal. I can deal with depression. And can I tell you, we have that for trials and suffering. There's just a lot of places for it. This is that psalm where he talks about his soul casting down and this hope in God. There is help from his countenance cast down. Therefore, I remember you, what you've done. It's cast down, but there is hope and there is help here. Absolutely wonderful. Absolutely truthful. It's what's real. And let me add this. Revelation to us, use this as directed, this truth. Use it as directed. Let me take a moment here to turn you to another place in Scripture. It's in the book of Hebrews, chapter 10. Would you turn there with me? Hebrews chapter 10. In Hebrews chapter 10, listen to how this talks about using revelation as directed. Starting in verse 19, therefore, brothers, you who are believers, you could have put sisters in here according to the way this is put in the New Testament. Therefore, brothers and sisters, those who are in Christ, since we have confidence to enter the holy place by the blood of Jesus. This is the very presence of God. We have this by the new and living way that He opened for us through the curtain, that is, through His own flesh, through what He bore on His body on the tree, our sin. He took our sin. And since we now have a great high priest over the house of God, Jesus, let us do some things. Let us
follow the directions. Let us use the revelation as directed. Let us draw near to God with a true heart, one that conforms to reality, in the full assurance of our trust in Him, with our hearts sprinkled clean and our evil conscience washed with this, what He's provided. Let us hold fast the confession of our hope. Two letters so far. Let us use this. Let's hold fast to this, our confident anticipation of the future without wavering, because He who promised is faithful. And let us consider, number three times he says, let us consider how to stir up one another to this love and to good works. Let's not neglect getting together as some have done, but let's do this all the more as we're seeing the day when John said, I looked and behold, a white horse as heaven opened, and Him who sat on it is faithful and true. And He comes and He demonstrates that He is reliable, and He is what is real, and what He says is what is conformed to reality. And it's easy to get lost and depressed about that between now and then. Then you won't be. You won't be. You can't be. Because faith becomes sight. So, Revelation, Hebrews 10. And I put a few others up here about what to use. When you're having trouble with fellowship, when trials or temptations, when there's suffering, here is sin involved. Cheerfulness when you're cheerful. Here, what to do when you have victory. All of this is truth to be used because it conforms to what's real. And this is what we go through our experience. Oh, the fellowship is off. I'm going through this trial. There's suffering. I sin. Cheerfulness. Reality that you conform to. This is calling on the Lord. This is calling on. This is calling on Him because He's faithful and He's true. And He goes as directed. So, last thing. What you can count on Him to do. What can we count on Him to do? Revelation for you. Come to grips with this. Back to Revelation chapter 19. What we can count Him to do is this. And in righteousness, He judges. Meaning that according to what is right, He evaluates. You know, there's actually two different ways this goes. There's the believer's way this goes, and there's the unbeliever's way this goes. There's those who are trusting Him, and those who line up against Him with their trust. And by the way, that's a progressive thing because we all kind of go there. It's learning to line up with Him in our trust, that I trust Him. This goes two ways, okay? What we can expect Him to do, revelation for us that we have to come to grips with, He judges according to what is right. Here, for believers, this is the judgment. That if you give a cup of water in Jesus' name, that He's faithful and true, and because He said this, I want to do this, what happens? You give a cup of water in Jesus' name, and what happens? What does God say? You will not lose your reward. Did you hear that? Why? Because He's true. Conforms to reality. I'm going to do what He said. I'm going to give a cup of water in Jesus' name. How big is that? How big is that to give a cup of water in Jesus' name? I mean, in some countries where they can't go to the tap and get it or pick up a bottle of it at the store and give it, it's like, but for us, it's kind of like, Doug does it at our D-band all around the table. He will not lose his reward. He will not lose his reward. He will not lose his reward. He goes, gets him, sets him up. He will not lose his reward. Wow. That's how it goes. You do this because he is faithful and true, and you want to do based on him being faithful and true what he asked you to do or uses directed, and you don't lose your reward. God rewards you for all eternity. I don't know what all his rewards are going to be for all those cups of water he's given, bottles of water, many of them. Many of them. But he gets them. Why does he get them? Because he gave the water. God's predictable. It's a pattern. You do it, I do it. That's how it goes. That is so deep. Wow. And that's for the believer. We all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, and we give an account for what we've done in the flesh, whether what we've done was beneficial to people or whether it was all about me. And if it's all about me and what my feel and my belly and all of that, and you do, then it becomes hay, wood, and stubble. And when he judges, he evaluates with his eyes, flame of fire, gone. That's it. Done. But if he does this, and you have done this because he's faithful and true, and you acted on it, then gold, silver, precious stones, fire refines them, and it's like, wow. That's what it is. That's how it works for the believer. Because their sin is all taken by the blood of Jesus Christ. Amen? That is a done deal. All of that is done by Jesus Christ. And we do this, and he rewards, and it's like, it even gets better than that, but I can't tell you that right now. For the non-believer here, this is really different. We're in Revelation 19. So flip over really quick to Revelation 20. Revelation chapter 20, verse 11. Look at what comes down here. There was a great white throne, and he, when this great white throne appeared, the heavens and the earth just, whoo, were gone. And everybody who ever lived, died, great and small, who weren't believers, who didn't trust Christ, they are taken care of earlier. These are the ones who come later when God evaluates them. And you know, when he talked about this, Jesus made this point very distinctive. For every idle word, they're going to give an account when they stand before God. Idle words. Do you ever say idle words? I mean, you're sitting there and just, woohoo! Oh, man! Out of words. And you, okay, why'd you say that word? I don't know. Okay, we'll evaluate that. They're judged by what they did according to these books, and they're judged according to their deeds, and their sentence comes, and that's what happens to the unbeliever. This is what he will do. When he judges in righteousness those who don't know Christ, those who line up against him. And look at this. He said this too. This is what he's going to do. And he will make war. He will make war with who? With those who line up against him, Antichrist. But for the believer is this. He who's called you is faithful. He will progressively make your life more and more and more and more like his son's life. Through the events of your life. You know, sometimes those events are not easy. They are hard. Sometimes I cry over those events. I almost cried when I heard about the Williamsons. Man, is that tough or what? They make you cry. But it's going somewhere. He's faithful, he's true. He doesn't waste what he's doing. He makes us like Christ. And for the non-believer, this. I'm going to end with this. This is so big, and then we've got a couple of announcements to make here. For the unbeliever, Romans chapter 2, verse 4 says this, that God is being kind and patient and forbearing with you so that the kindness of God will lead you to change your mind. Change your mind about what God you're living for. The God of your belly or the God who's real? God's kindness does that.
And then, for us who are believers, we are to imitate God in kindness like that. I want to introduce you to something. See this? This is Tin Man's cap. No, actually it's not. This is a hard hat. It's a hard hat that's got a hole in the top. You know what this is for? This is for collection. Heartland has a challenge. It's a challenge. It's a challenge that's going to call for us to rely on Old Faithful, not the geezer or geyser, and to call on the name of the Lord. You see, there's a timetable for this building we're in. The timetable is that they want to start consolidating. And this school is going to be rendered out of the school system. And the timetable is that probably in about a year, we will need to go somewhere else. Where shall we go? Well, we've been talking about this and talking about this and talking about this. And as we've talked about it, we've thought, you know, Heartland needs to move forward. So there's been a building fund established, and that's what Tin Face here is about. It's collecting a building. And you know, the very hour that this was established, it was $150 given. And when that $150 went in, someone else gave $100, and there's been another $100. And right now, this thing has $350 in it. And Heartland has a goal. It's a challenge. We've looked at some land. As a matter of fact, we talked about it yesterday. I went out and walked it off. And I looked at the surrounding areas. And we have a goal. The goal is $100,000, where should we go? This is what we've done. $100,000 to be raised here by our ministry via the internet and by our fellow workers here doing things to raise money and to give it, and just offerings of generosity, $100,000. Can we do it? I think there's someone who is faithful, and we can call on this and we can ask him. Right? So this is commenced. It's got $350 to this moment, according to my knowledge, and it'll be on the back table, and we will progress, because in a year's time, we've got to decide what we're doing. And we've got to do it as a body, together. Because guess what? Without you, there's no church. You are the church. And let's see, is God faithful? Yep. I'm going to pick up the dough before somebody else does. Father in heaven, we look to you forever. Faithful. Amen.